afternoon. Welcome to the Middle East, a mosaic of history, art, and culture. I'm Jasmine Nabens, curator of lectures, courses, and concerts. Today's class, Visions of the Middle East, Photographs from 1839 to Today, will be presented by the Estrellita and Yousef Karsh Assistant Curator of Photographs, and in my opinion, MFA superstar, Kristen Gresh. Kristen is a photo historian and received her PhD in the history of photography from the School of Cairo Studies in Social Sciences in Paris, France. She has published numerous articles, including ones in the journal History of Photography and Etudes Photographiques. She spent numerous years living abroad, namely in Paris and Cairo. And she has been at the MFA since January of 2012 and is the curator of the current exhibition, She Who Tells a Story. Yes. I'm so glad that Kristen was able to be a part of this course. Please join me in welcoming her today.
Thank you all for being here today, and thank you for your warmth about my exhibition, which is currently on view. So today we're going to go back in history and start with the beginning of the photographic medium around 1839. And I want to just, before I start, let you know that this will be a very general overview of photography of and in the Middle East, starting from the beginning of the creation of photography. And I'll highlight many of the photographers. There's also many which we won't have a chance to talk about. But sort of the main thing that I'll be doing going through will be talking about photography's importance in the representation of the, and sort of in the visual representation of the Middle East. So there are many parallels with the history of geography and the history of photography. So we'll be really thinking about photography as a technology that was evolving over all of this time from 1839 to today, and how that's affected our visual knowledge of this rich region of the Middle East. So early photographs of subjects ranging from pyramids and sacred biblical sites to staged harems invariably reflect the European imagination and conception of the Middle East. And I just want to throw out a few paintings before we get to photographic matters to actually talk about the idea of Orientalism, which is a word that's thrown around a lot, I think, when we talk about the history of painting and the history of the Middle East. This here is a painting by Anga. It's called the Odalisque from 1814. And it's a good classic example of an Orientalist painting. There were many European paintings looking to the Middle East and to the East in general and depicting different types of scenes. Here we have Eugene Delacroix, the Women of Algiers. And this is a harem scene. And so I think it's important to point out this style of painting called Orientalism is by painters who some had traveled to the quote East. They were probably denied entrance to authentic harems, and the male artist relied largely on hearsay and imagination, and then used, you know, in their paintings had opulently decorated interiors, luxuriant odalisques, sometimes with female slaves. So it was very much about a combination of potentially some architectural structures that they knew or had seen reproductions of, and then very much of their imagination. And so there is an implicit eroticism in these paintings. And the taste for Orientalism in general, or this interest and almost exoticism of the East, continued in different European styles of architecture and even in the decorative arts. And so I want to go forward. Here's another painting of Fromma, of the Odalisque with a Slave. And so we will get to photography. And this is the last painting that I'm going to show you, or not painting, but non-photograph. And this is an incredibly important publication called The Description of Egypt. and the description of Egypt was an important series of publications appearing first in 1809 and continuing until its final volume in 1829. So it's a very comprehensive scientific description of ancient and modern Egypt, as well as of Egypt's natural history. So it's actually a collaborative work of almost 200 civilian scholars and scientists who accompanied Napoleon's expedition to Egypt from 1798 and in 1801. And there were probably about 2,000 artists and technicians, including 400 engravers, who compiled the different reproductions to make up these 24 volumes of the description of Egypt. And so the description of Egypt is an incredibly important series of publications that really contributed to informing Western knowledge of the Middle East. So in this slide on the left, we have the sort of frontispiece of one of the volumes, and we also have an engraving. And the these publications are these enormous albums of which many plates have been removed, but there just was a great deal of collaboration to create this documentation of Napoleon's expeditions to Egypt. So I want to point out, in terms of the description of Egypt, there actually is a very specific connection to photography, because in 1839, when the announcement of the daguerreotype was made by astronomer François Arago to the Academy of Sciences, in his remarks and presentation of this new medium, which of course the daguerreotype being a mirror plate and a, you know, rather ephemeral type of image, he says to this scientific group, when sort of, you know, talking about all of the excitement of this new medium, he says, to copy the millions of hieroglyphs covering only the exterior of the great monuments of Thebes, Memphis, Karnak, 20 years and scores of draftsmen would be required. With the daguerreotype, a single man could execute this immense task. And the new images would surpass in fidelity and local color the work of our most skilled artists. So I think this is an important point to make, that they were presenting photography as this new scientific technology that could replace artists, literally. I mean, he says, you know, it would surpass our most skilled artists. So I think this is important because some of the ideas about this new technology was the idea of most accurately recording what they were seeing, and particularly in the discovery of many aspects of Egypt. So it was an exaggeration on the part of Arago in terms of the daguerreotype being able to literally replace all of these draftsmen, because the daguerreotype was very expensive and required very long exposures, and the images could not be replicated. So it wouldn't be able to produce something like the description of Egypt. So the precise mirror-like images, ephemeral quality, did not quite fit in with the description of Egypt, but his statement did convey the urgency associated with photography from the beginning, and that was to capture, record, and document aspects of current civilization, and as we'll talk about to start with, will be of Egypt. So this idea of the efficiency and fidelity of the new medium is an important part of its history, and from then on, different government institutions sent teams of photographers to participate in some of the expeditions and be recording different aspects of what they were seeing. So Félix Thénard is the first photographer that I'll show you work by, and I've tried to, particularly with the 19th century photographs that I'll be showing you, choose photographs from our MFA collection. So a majority of these are from our collection. Félix Thénard published 160 calotypes, and a calotype is a salted paper print which was patented after the daguerreotype, and it was the first positive print process. It has a matte, and I'll show you some images in a moment, but it has a matte surface with a soft appearance, and diffuse details, and it was used basically from the 1840s to the 1860s. So Thénard, who was a French civil engineer, visited Egypt starting in 1851. He was very interested in buildings and set out to do photographic surveys, and his specific intention was to be a complement to the description of Egypt. So this here is Abu Simbel. And this photograph is the monument carved into bedrock pillars and carved sculptures of the left side of Edur in Nubia, also taken in 1851-2. And Thénard, it's important, I think, to mention that Thénard was a civil engineer. So, you know, to put these photographs into their context and realize that this idea of, you know, particularly in this case, the French expeditioners and travelers, you know, in this moment of French imperialism, the ideas of going to new lands and recording it is an essential element of the work. So Thénard's images were more wide-ranging than others, and he featured, I mean, here we have these bedrock pillars, and we can see some of the detail in the background, but there are other photographs of village architecture, cemetery, and landscapes in an attempt to provide this complement to the description of Egypt. And I wanted to just quote Thénard to sort of give you an idea of the importance of the process in their experience. So he says, "Several photographers are far from being above reproach, but perhaps the traveler can be granted a little indulgence when his painstaking work is carried out in a location like Egypt. Isolated in a region without resources, he is able to rely only on himself. A nomad, his working method is always provisional, and the delicate preparations for his photography must be carried out on a small sailing boat rocking on the water or under a tent in the midst of a desert." So I think when we see some of these majestic images and these incredible sights that we imagine the 19th century traveler photographing, we don't always remember the laborious process of actually getting their equipment to the site, and then having to, you know, prepare the negatives, and then to develop their work right there. So I want to show you another photographer, Maxime Ducamp, who also was a writer and romantic traveler, who also did these salted paper prints. Ducamp accomplished an extensive series of 220 paper negative prints on his journey up the Nile and across the Sinai from between 1849 and 51, and 125 of those salted paper prints were published in the first photographically illustrated travel book. And so this idea of the travel book was a new thing, or photographically illustrated travel book was a new thing at the time, and that was called Egypt, Nubia, Palestine, and Syria, and it was published in 1952. So this is one of our photographs, again, of Abu Simbel by Maxime Ducamp. And he had actually been commissioned in 1849 to photograph Egypt's monuments with their hieroglyphic inscriptions, and he traveled with the writer Gustave Flaubert for months in Egypt. And when he wrote about his work, he said, "Learning to photograph is not too hard, but transporting all the equipment you need on the back of a mule, camel, or man is really hard work." So it gives us a further appreciation of these incredible images here, where we can't see all of Abu Simbel, but we see sort of the tops of some of these statues. And this is another calotype salted print, which is actually the mosque and tomb of Mourad Bey, also by Maxime Ducamp. And what's interesting to say is that there are photographs by Ducamp which do have people in them, but for all of his publications, none of the photographs with people were ever chosen. And I think that's an important, and we'll see later some photographs that do have people, but at that time in the mid-19th century, the idea was to show only the sites. And so we'll see in this first part of photographs the absence, particularly with Thénard and Ducamp, the absence of the Egyptian in these photographs. So I'd like now to talk about Francis Frith, who did three photographic expeditions in the Middle East, and was an incredibly prolific photographer, and also became a very important publisher of travel images. So he used the recently introduced wet plate process, and so he did not use the salted paper print, but actually the wet plate process enabled one to have much crisper images and permitted near-perfect copy negatives necessary for large-scale production of prints in multiple formats. So it would be mammoth plates, stereos, and he photographed stage scenes in which European travelers could walk through the ancient site. So again, an absence of the Egyptian, although we do see some of those, but he basically had an understanding of what his viewers wanted from travel photographs. And it was frequently a scene that they could engage with imaginatively rather than an accurate but dull record of place. So he was, as I said, a very prolific publisher and stopped photographing altogether in 1860 to dedicate himself entirely to his publishing outfit. But he did publish two editions of an illustrated Bible, which I'll show you a photograph from momentarily. This is the Ramesseum of El Kourneh, the Thebes First View, and this is again from our collection. And so here we actually do have some figures. So this is slightly different than some of the details that we'll see in a moment. Sorry, I'm just... and this here is from Egypt and Palestine. And I want to point out that he traveled in a covered wagon where he slept and worked, and he sometimes used tombs for dark rooms. And actually, yeah, it's really amazing to think about. And just to talk about the actual process, he was using these glass plate negatives, and the negative had to be coated with a mixture of gun cotton, ether, and alcohol, and then inserted into the camera while still wet. So you can imagine, and with that, they had to make sure there would be no dust or anything that would, you know, interrupt the image or take away from the perfect print that they were searching for. And so for the most industrious photographer, they, you know, would probably produce a maximum of 6 photographs a day. So that's, I think, an important thing to think about also in terms of these types of images that we're looking at. And I actually have a quote, but I wanted to give you that just a moment because my mouse has disappeared. Oops. Sorry, it's not showing up on the screen. All right, well, we're not going to read the quote now, but anyway, it was actually about, again, the amount of material that Frith always had with him, and he had a large table at all times that was also a wooden box where we would have a dozen or so flasks of different chemicals, and he would have to have extra plates. They would need to have a tripod, and let's not forget that he actually had to have the camera with him as well. So, I mean, and the camera could weigh up to 25 pounds. So it just is an incredibly important process to be thinking about as we look at these spectacular photographs. So as I mentioned, Frith was a publisher, and this is actually one photograph from an album that we have of 76 albumen prints. And so the albumen prints were made with this new wet collodion negative process, or the wet plate process that I described. And this is one from that series, which again is a very majestic view of Abu Simbel. And this photograph, which is the view at Hebron, is a part of one of his illustrated Bibles. So we have here, particularly in Frith's photographs, Egyptian antiquities from pharaonic times, but we also have specific sites related to the Bible and related to what, I mean, he was very much a businessman at the same time as an astute publisher, really publishing what he, you know, seemed that the demand was. And so that was related to the Holy Land and to Egyptian antiquities. And I should point out, he is British, and the first two that we talked about were French, and they were frequently being commissioned by French government expedition crews, and fifth is working out of England at the time. And this is the Pyramids of Saqqara, and this is again an alchemic print from white collodion on glass negative. And I think if you think about those first images that I showed you, they are much softer focus, and here we can really feel the crisp details here, and which are, you know, definitely a result of this new process that really opened up many opportunities for photographers. And this one is particularly beautiful with the pyramid in the distance. And I should say that this is such a small selection of Frith's photographs. He ended up publishing 8 photographically illustrated books containing more than 400 images. So when we think about just the process of taking one and comparing the negative, that it, you know, shows that this glittering new technology of the album print really enabled him to produce wonderful publications. So back to a French photographer, Gustave Le Gray. He went to Egypt with the writer Alexandre Dumas and ended up staying in Egypt for the rest of his life. So I'll show you a small selection of, again, albumen prints. This is from the Temple of Edfu from 1867. And, you know, we'll talk in a little bit about the presence of the Egyptian, but in general, there's much more focus on the land and on these sites. And there have been many arguments made that, one thing I didn't mention, just rewinding a little bit to the discussion of Orientalism. In 1978, the Palestinian-born scholar Edward Said wrote a seminal book called Orientalism, where he talks about, for example, the style of Orientalist painting or Orientalist literature that is depicting Eastern societies. He paralleled those representations, either visual or literary, with imperial notions on the behalf of the European writers, painters, etc. So frequently when we talk about Orientalism, basically from 1978 on, we have this idea of Said's commentary about it, which is implying that there is this colonialist attitude in some of the representation. So when reading a lot of the travelogues of these photographers from the 19th century, like Le Gray or Frith or Thénard or Ducamp, the way they talk about their experience really makes them sound very much like, you know, expeditioners and these travelers, and they talk about the experience of being lost or have, you know, the different either communication difficulties or what have you, but they do make themselves out to be these sort of larger than life presences and don't always, you know, take into account that there is a contemporary civilization that's living there. So that, I think, is very distinct in these photographs as well, is that most of the 19th century photographs of Egypt, for example, in this case, or other countries like Syria, we have the Egyptian is always very small. And so we realize the power of photography to reveal very much, but also to conceal. And so, you know, Egypt is being presented continually throughout the 19th century as sort of absent and not having a modern civilization, which has, you know, contributed to the visual history of the country and region of that time. This is another photograph by Le Gray. And this actually, you know, we do have a group of people there. And so Le Gray, because he ended up living there, is one that actually has a little bit more human presence than, for example, Frith or Ducamp. And this is an example of a non-pharaonic site, but a mausoleum that is important to show the variety of different types of photographs that Le Gray took. And so it was after 1860 that photography in Egypt was then dominated by professional commercial photographers who produced technically competent standardized views. So there were a number of studios that actually catered to tourists who flooded into Egypt under new package tours that were beginning in the late 1860s. And that was the same year that distinguished Europeans such as Adolf Braun, who traveled to Egypt to cover the opening of the Suez Canal, but he also photographed some more classic images of the pyramids. And these are, you know, a lot of these photographs we feel like we've seen before because they've entered into our very sort of present visual iconography of Egypt. And here, these are the Giza pyramids of Khufu and Khafra and the Great Sphinx. And so I want to point out, as we talk about this evolution of the photographic medium, I mentioned travel books, and then there were also guidebooks, which actually directed visitors to go to studios based, you know, in Cairo or other parts of the Middle East, where tourists could obtain views, I mean, basically like buying a postcard, they could obtain views that they would then include in their own photographic albums. And so many studios popped up. One is of Siba, which we'll look at in a minute, and there's also Biatu, the Zangaki brothers, Lege Kayan, and then the studio of Bonfils. And so those images were archaeological sites, antiquities in the Cairo Museum, atmospheric views of the Nile, and costume studies of ethnographic types, as well as genre scenes. So, here we have an Arab village, and so this, again, would be something that a traveler might then take home and put in their personal photographic album. And then same with this, is the Temple of Edfu in Upper Egypt. And this is the Great Sphinx of Giza looking southwest. And again, we see this, we do, you know, we're starting to see a little bit of a presence, but the person is more part of the scenery than actually being the focus of the portrait, or of the photograph. And I just wanted to show you an example of an album created by this Siba studio, which this is just one plate of the album, but it's an album of Constantinople, and so this large document that has photographs of, you know, Constantinople throughout, and this is a mosque in particular, and to realize a lot of 19th century photography that we see originated in this type of album. And so this idea of commercialization is very important, and the commercialization of these photographs began to actually collapse the distinction between the experience of a place and the acquisition of its photographic representation. And that's simply something, certainly, that with the internet today, we can all understand, you know, the experience of a place through an image is a question worth thinking about, and particularly in this case, when there was a great deal of travel, and the actual acquisition of a photographic representation, you know, might have had to, at some point, especially in the late 19th century, go, you know, to some of these local studios and get them, whereas later the albums and such that were actually available in Europe. But they weren't always easily accessible. So it's an important, again, sort of factor that is important so when we look at these photographs. So this here is an albumen print by Felix Bonfils, and it was taken again in the mid-19th century, and it's the Temple of Isis in Egypt. And here we have the top of these columns, so we can see that they're really getting into detail, and I mentioned how some of these details then later became part of certain decorative arts in Europe. So all of these photographs together really have become our visual understanding of the Middle East at the time. And here's the Temple of Luxor, the temple and the obelisk on the Nile. And I should mention, just in terms of ideas of archaeology and archaeological expeditions, I'm sure you all know that or have seen pictures of the Concorde, the place of the Concorde in Paris, which has, here we see one of the obelisks, and in fact, the other obelisk that should be on the other side wasn't yet in France when this photograph was taken, but eventually it was given as a gift to the French government to thank Champollion, the archaeologist who had been one of the lead archaeologists working in these expeditions. So there is a deep connection with this sort of expeditions in Egypt and basically still stemming from the description of Egypt, but that then began a tradition of sort of surveying the geography and understanding more about, Egyptology itself sort of began with French Egyptologists, archaeologists. So here I just wanted to show you a different photograph by Wolfis, which is a general view of the tombs of the caliphs and the citadel of Cairo. It's again an album in print. And so I wanted to just show us again the description of Egypt and point out again this that absent from a vast majority of the photographic depictions of 19th century Egypt was any reference to a modernizing society with contemporary inhabitants. So, the photographs were basically a procession of ancient sites which had been cleared and resembled, and sometimes when I say cleared, they had been photographs that were then selected and collected together in sometimes exhibitions or albums, and so really a range of quaint street scenes to quasi-ethnographic studies. And so these images widely became the sort of representation of Egypt. However, there was, and again, I should just point out of all the photographs we just saw, they were these incredibly cumbersome, they had all the material that I mentioned, they were carrying the folding tents, were developing in dark rooms, and the possibilities really opened up a great deal when the gelatin dry plate negative was invented in 1871, and then improved in 1878. So photography really expanded a great deal at that time, and there was a sort of new possibilities for many, and in particular there was the reinstatement of a photographic tour as a medium of popular instruction. And this here is an example. In 1905, Underwood and Underwood marketed a set of 100 stereographs. And it was called Egypt Through the Stereograph, Through the Stereoscope. And so it was a complete tour of Egypt, and it was showing its antiquities, but these little cards were, number one, much easier to make in terms of the process, and it enabled a larger variety of people to be photographing. So I want to point out that it wasn't only Europe who was sending their archaeologists and teams of surveyors and engineers and artists to Egypt. In fact, the Harvard University and our here, the Museum of Fine Arts Boston, we did an important expedition between 1902 and 1942. And there were about 35,000 black and white excavation photographs taken in that time period. And so even today, I mean, this is an archive that is actively studied, and it was the single longest running Giza excavation that took place, with Harvard and the MFA. And they unearthed thousands of Giza artifacts and amassed pretty much the largest archaeological documentary archive of any Giza expedition. And just thinking about this mass of photographs, 35,000 photographs, that the photographic medium and these specific objects are actually playing an incredibly important role in reconstructing the past with this visual evidence. So I'll show you one photograph from that archive. This is the Muslim Feast of Sacrifice. And this is another side of photography that, although we do see photographs that might be like this on the museum walls, but we don't always think about the actual objects that were used for archival purposes. So I wanted to point that out. And I'm not sure if K.A.C. Creswell has come up in any of your courses up until today, but he was an English architectural historian who wrote some of the seminal works on Islamic architecture in Egypt. And as part of his surveys, he actually took incredibly extensive amounts of photographs of almost every, the major Islamic different mosques. And he published, or he took so many photographs that, in fact, not nearly all of them have been published before, but there are two archives of them today that are regularly studied by Islamic architecture historians, particularly because when anything has either been restored or renovated, these are the objects that they're able to turn to, because, you know, in the same way that many French and British photographers took these images of Egyptian antiquities in the 19th century, at the beginning of the 20th century, he really was incredibly active photographing every possible monument that he could related to the history of Islamic art. So I just wanted to point out a few of these. And most historical photographs that you see of Islamic architecture are in fact by K.A.C. Gutwell. So we see the variety of outsiders or Europeans photographing in the Middle East, which present an incredibly rich presentation and representation of the medium. But that is very sort of important to complement with local studio photographers, because thanks to this presence of photographers throughout the 19th century and these commercial studios that opened up in the late 19th century, local photographers began to photograph as well. So we're actually going to shift our eyes to another country, which I haven't talked about yet, which is Iran. And the photographer Antoine Sevrigan, who is a European of Georgian origin, but who was a resident in Iran during the late 19th century. And I should point out, he basically made his life in Iran. So he had sort of what I guess we sometimes call a hyphenated identity, being of Georgian origin, but being Iranian as well. In Iran at the time, in the late 19th century, he was connected to the Qajar monarchy, and particularly Nasser al-Din Shah was actually a Qajar monarch who was a photographer himself and found photography to be incredibly important. So Sevrigan did a lot of photographing for the court and was really involved in royal portraitures. So to give you an example here, and I should mention that Sevrigan managed and operated one of the most successful commercial photography studios in Tehran. He was born, some publications say he was born in 1830, others say 1840, and he died in 1933. So regardless of his actual birthday, he lived a very long life. And he really had two goals in his photographs. One wanted to show the different aspects of Iran, and so he was not focusing on monuments, although there are equally spectacular monuments to be photographed in Iran, but was really interested in photographing people. This is an interesting photograph, which is clearly a specific ritual, and it's a specific dance that was performed. And he wanted to capture the different facets of Iran, and he wanted to also capture the effect of light in his photographs, and was a very sort of pronounced Rembrandt fan. So he did these survey of photographs. This here is a dervish or cleric from the 1870s. So you can see here we've started to now see portraiture, which isn't entirely by a local photographer, but it is someone that's connected with the region and isn't just showing up as a traveler with all of their equipment. So he really would engage with his sitters, but was also aware of typographic photography and sort of this idea of ethnographic presentations. What's interesting here, this is a portrait of a Persian woman dressed in a ballerina costume. And all of these photographs always seem to identify the type of person. So the fact that the actual title is Persian woman, I think is very important. And the ballerina costume is also important. We'll see reference to that later. Here, these are two young women also in traditional dress, and actually they can be compared with these portrait of two Kurdish women in elaborate costume. So the fact that each of these figures are identified by their origin, I think, tells us a lot about the concepts of identity, even at that time in contemporary Iran, during the Qajar era. Here's a Persian school, so we have a group photograph, which is, you know, different than the portrait photograph, but again, we see Severgan's connection with the Iranian people, and the fact that he has such a range of figures, you know, ranging from the dervish or cleric to then a school. So he really is giving us now a much wider representation of Persian civilization at the time, and we learn more about the people and get a little bit closer to the actual sort of human history of the country. And so I wanted to point out, basically after this incredibly rich 19th century period of travel photography, there were these photographers who frequently had these hybrid identities, like Severgan, in different cities. And so the other one that I want to discuss today is the photographer Van Leo. He was born as Levon Alexander Boyajan, and he was an Armenian Egyptian photographer who actually arrived in Egypt as a baby. His parents had left Armenia when he was only months old, and they settled in Cairo. And so he became known for his numerous self-portraits and also portraits of celebrities of his time. So this is a little bit later than Severgan, and as I mentioned, we're just sort of going forward in time, seeing some major highlights. There's actually several Armenian Egyptian photographers who set up studios in Cairo around the same time. Van Leo was born in 1921. So his studio, I think he opened in the early 40s, mid-40s, and he was not the, you know, there was the studio Venus, which existed before he opened, and he was very inspired by that, but there was also Armand. There were many, many portrait photographers operating in Cairo, and for that matter, in Beirut and Damascus at the time. But I wanted to point out Van Leo because he has been the one whose legacy has sort of become the most important. There's the largest archive of his work, which is in both Cairo and Beirut today. And he was able to make ordinary people into film stars, basically. And I should mention that really amazing photograph. He actually, in the late 40s, he was sort of got this job at the opera to take photographs of people that were coming to see the opera and also the performers. And so this is, I mean, the, you know, the stage effect of all of these photographs are incredibly powerful. And this one is called Coptic Woman, 1949. So again, this specific identity. And here is, he did do many studio portraits, but this happens to be an outside portrait of a famous Egyptian actor named Karsh. And I should mention, just in look, actually, let me go back to this one. In looking at the many photographs, he was very particular about his signature, and he also was very in tune with light. And he was very inspired by Yousef Karsh, another, of course, Armenian-born photographer, but working in Canada. But Van Leo was very aware throughout his entire career of what Karsh was doing and of the type of portraits that he really sought to emulate in many ways. So while Van Leo was very connected to the commercial world, you know, taking a whole range of portraits, some people that were very famous and others that weren't, and many, many people in Egypt today can say, oh, I have a portrait of my grandparents from, by Van Leo. So although he was very active commercially in his portrait studio, he also was doing some incredibly innovative photography for the time and for Egypt, which are his series of self-portraits. So you can see this incredibly surreal representation of himself, and he basically, in terms of identity itself, and perhaps because he had his own hybrid identity, but he has an amazing range of self-portraits where he's dressed, you know, he has a gun, he has different paraphernalia, but I wanted to show you this one, which he hand painted. And he then actually did a whole series of work that he hand painted, and this one is of Sherry Han, who was a young Egyptian actress. And so he actually has two, this is a very well-known image of Sherry Han, and as is this one. So these are pretty incredible photographs, and because the archive has remained relatively intact, I think this has also enabled younger shot photographers to be very aware of his work and also very influenced by it. I should mention that there is that a group, an archive that was founded in Beirut about probably 15 years ago called the Arab Foundation for the Image, where they're actively seeking any archive of Arab world photography that they can find. So it's a pretty amazing growing archive where they're collecting bits of work from sometimes families or institutions, and Van Leeuwis have photographs there. But I think because Van Leeuwis archive has been sort of more known, it's really contributed to influencing future photographers. So here's yet another painted, hand-painted portrait. And I wanted to sort of immediately show you, a younger photographer born in 1972, Yousef Nabib, who really does much of his work either emulating Van Leeuwis self-portraits or just his hand-colored photographs. So, this photograph is of the photographer Shireen Nishat, who's an Iranian-born photographer. And you can see the similarities between these photographs that Nabib was just incredibly inspired by. In Egypt at the time, you know, the one well-known photographer is Van Leeuwis, so we can see the direct effects of his work inspiring younger artists. And this is a portrait of the photographer Malik Sidibe, another hand-painted photograph. And these are very recent. This was taken in 2004, and this was taken in 2011. So you can see decades later the influence. I want to actually now turn our, so we're sort of going back and forth, seeing the region photographed from inside and out. But I wanted to just show you a few photographs, basically starting in the early sort of when photojournalism and photo documentary became more present in Europe and the United States. It did in Egypt as well and in other Middle Eastern countries. But there was, because much of the press was nationalized, there was a fair amount of censorship. So we don't actually have extensive records of press photography or of commercial, you know, commercial for magazines or newspapers from the mid-20th century. There are some at the Arab Image Foundation, but I wanted to just show you what some American and European photographers were, aspects of the Middle East that they were photographing, because I think despite the fact that there were local studio photographers, you know, based in Tehran or Cairo, as we saw Sevrigan or Van Leo, there are also photographers, 20th century, both artists and photojournalists, that were continuing to photograph the 20th century and inform our visual knowledge of the region. So this is actually a photograph by Paul Strand of Fatma Ahmed in Upper Egypt. And so this is from 1959. So it's a very sensitive portrait, which, you know, we don't necessarily associate Paul Strand immediately with Egypt, so I wanted to just point that out. And this photograph and the next few photographs are by photographers that were in the Magnum Photography Agency, which began in 1947. And when this agency, which was founded sort of with photographers both in Paris and New York, by photojournalist Robert Capa and four others, the way they set up their structures, they said, okay, we don't want to work for press, you know, outlets anymore. We're each going to choose a part of the world and go photograph that, and that'll be our area. So George Roger was initially assigned to the Middle East, and this is a photograph by the photographer George Roger of Iraq. So we can see here the market with this incredible light. And so we can see now that we're 100 or so years later, after the salted paper prints and the albumen prints, we have here, you know, 35 millimeter, these photographers that have their light does, and it's a different type of photography that is accessible because you don't have to set up the tripod, and so it's affecting our sort of visual knowledge again of that. And this is Henri Cartier-Bresson, who also photographed in Iraq, and this is from 1950. So it's an incredible photograph. Again, with an entirely new perspective, I should point out, the earlier photographs that we saw were very majestic and about the monument, but here, because of this altered perspective, and it's not a straight on shot or it's not from above, we actually see there's much more attention being paid to the actual figure. And this is a time when photography is starting to be called, or some styles of photography is sort of being thought of as more humanistic, so we do see the presence of the human figure more. This is also a photographer who was associated with Magnum photographers, with Magnum agency. Her name is Eve Arnold. And the caption of this, and we'll talk a little bit about the representation of the veil in a little bit, and I know that you'll hear a lot more about it next week, but this, the caption of this photograph was, "Egyptian women are still veiled," 1970. But I find it interesting because this is a very traditional represent, you know, this is a very traditional dress. And I should say that in the Van Leo archive, if you look at all of the portraits, as time goes on, actually there's more veiling as opposed to less veiling. So in fact, in the Van Leo portraits of Egyptian women in the 1970s and 80s, there are practically no veiled women in those portraits, and it's actually later, but we'll talk about the representation of veil momentarily. This is another amazing photograph. This is also a photographer associated with Magnum photographer, Magnum Agency, and this is Bruno Barbi, who has published a few books on Morocco specifically, and again, it's no longer about the whole monument, but it's about these details, and it's about the, you know, the figure and the architecture simultaneously. So this is the Ismail mausoleum. It's a Muslim shrine. And I now am going to, with that brief sort of parentheses of photographers from the outside, I want to go back to photographers from the region. And I'll start with Bahman Jalali. He was Iran's first documentary photographer, who was working in the 60s, 70s, 80s. He actually became a professor of the history of photography and of photography practice. And with his wife, who's also a photographer, Rana Javedi, they were collaborated in founding the National Museum for Photography in Tehran, in Iran. And I wanted to show you some of his very recent work before he died. This is from 2009. He was very active during the Iranian Revolution in 1979 and was one of the major photographers of that revolution. But this newer work, or work from later in his life, is actually, he started photographing abandoned cinemas where the posters had graffiti written all over the posters. So these are just details that are actually combining the very rich history of Iranian cinema and contemporary graffiti, and then he's adding another layer to it by creating these very powerful and colorful photographs that really make a specific reference to Iran's own visual history. So I just included two of those. And I wanted to highlight another Iranian photographer who's actually more known probably as a photojournalist. His name is Abbas, and he's also a member of Magnum Photographer Agency. He also actually, in fact, outside of Iran, we see, most of our photographs that we see of the Iranian Revolution are actually by Abbas. And so the caption of this is, "Ayatollah Ruhollah Khomeini's portrait is exhibited by the crowd attending the opening of the university," and that's in 1979. So Abbas has absolutely incredible photographs. This one is from 2004, and it's taken in Cairo, and it's called Veiling Cairo. And there's actually a rather lengthy description of that title there, which I probably don't have time to go into because I want to show you everything here. So another photograph by Abbas that I do want to tell you a little bit more about. This is from 1997, when Iran was at a political crossroads. And I should just say, photography, and particularly the photographs that we've seen, I think, you know, conceal some things, but also reveal an intimate relationship between art and politics, whether it's politics of, you know, imperial expeditions in a certain part of the region, or this photograph that's documenting the newly elected president of Iran in 1997, President Khatami. And here, this is actually the Iranian film director Abbas Kiarostami on the hill surrounding the capital, where his film Taste of Cherry, which received an award in 1997, was shot. So it's sort of this moment where they're thinking about the crossroads and this wonderfully sort of ironic image of this filmmaker sneaking a peek behind these doors that are actually surrounded by space everywhere. So it's just a wonderfully ironic photograph again by Abbas. Abbas took this photograph in Iraq, in Baghdad, in 2003. Welcome, USA, as we see with this crossed out. So this is important, you know, aesthetically it's an incredible composition and a very powerful photograph, and of course politically it represents a certain moment in time, particularly in relation to Iraq-American relations. This here is also 2003, so Abbas went to Saudi Arabia during the Hajj pilgrimage and photographed this incredible image. And the Hajj, I should say, is and has been for the past few decades a subject of a great many photographic series, which are always very powerful, but this aerial perspective is pretty amazing. And so I showed you Bahman Jalali, who was based in Iran and did both documentary and creative photography. And then I showed you Abbas, who is sort of a citizen of the world, mainly based in Paris, but frequently in New York, but still travels very regularly to Iran. And now I want to talk about Shireen Nishat, who some of you may have seen this work in the exhibition. She who tells a story. And this actually leads me to sort of mentioning, in relation to She Who Tells a Story, now that you've heard a very sort of quick overview of some of the history of photography in the Middle East, I'll just point out that for She Who Tells a Story, the photographs that I chose are a very new, starting in the 1990s, sort of part of a movement of creative photography that's explored many levels of identity. And as we can see, identity has gone through all of the photographs that I've just shown you, because it's all of the Middle East. And whether it's an outsider looking in or an insider looking out, we have these multiple layers of national, cultural, and human identity, and you know, monumental identity as well. So Shireen Nishat is a photographer who in the 1970s came to the United States and was here during the Iranian Revolution of 1979. And she didn't go back to Iran until the early 90s. And she talks about her return to her homeland, and she said it was like everything had turned black and white. And she was making specific reference to the fact that after the Iranian Revolution, women were required to wear a headscarf. And so she was surprised, because they were wearing black headscarves, to just see the visual change in Tehran. And that inspired her to stage herself in these photographs called, in the series is called Women of Allah. So this is a very particular moment in time that I want to talk about, because all of a sudden, for the first time, I've talked about the photographers from the outside, Europeans going to the Middle East, or, you know, local studio photographers, but they're not, other than Van Leo, there are very few photographers staging themselves. And so Shireen Nishat, in the early 90s, decided to do this work, although, yes, it was done in other places, but there haven't, you know, there hadn't been the same exploration to this extent, and so intimately linked with a national history. So the Women of Allah series is her reaction to the Islamic Revolution of Iran and the fact that she couldn't participate in it. So she's staging herself. She was fascinated to learn that there were many female warriors during the Iranian Revolution. And she did this incredible series where she writes in calligraphy on the actual photographs. And when asked about that process, she talks about, she also is a filmmaker, and she says, for me, writing on the photographs, and she chooses extracts from poems and from contemporary prose, she said, it's the same as when I put music to my film. So this idea of using more than one art form in a single object in the film, having the soundtrack and the music, and in her photographs, this is why she uses the writing on each of these photographs. So here we have this wonderful image of the, you know, red and black calligraphy literally turning the face of the figure into a target. So I also just want to, in terms of thinking about the many levels of identity and a lot of this work being a reaction or response to contemporary political events or a response to specifically technology of photography, I wanted to show this new series by Shireen Nishat, which is also on view in the Foster Gallery. And this is called the Book of Kings series, and this is a direct response to the Arab Spring and to the Iranian Green Movement. So the photographer is no longer using the headscarf or any representation of the veil in this new work. And I'll talk about that again in a few minutes, but I just want to point this out that The Book of Kings is the translation of a Persian manuscript, or it's the translation of the title of a Persian manuscript, which is the Shahnameh. And she was directly inspired by that because it told the tales of heroic deeds and noble rulers. So just to give you a sense of her work, she is the most well-known Iranian-born artist, probably, you know, contemporary, probably in the world today. And I want to now turn our eyes back to a photographer who's based in Iran still today, who's much younger than Shireen Nishat, but who was a student of Bahman Jalali. So the photographer who was looking at those old cinema posters and thinking about the past of Iranian cinema inspired, or, you know, worked probably with his student. This Shadi Ghazgiri was actually Bahman Jalali's student at the time, and Shadi Ghazgiri actually found the backdrop that we see there, which was a Persian studio photographer's actual background. So it had been used in the 19th century, and she used it to create this contemporary series, which you'll remember the photograph of the Persian women in the ballerina costume. And you know, we see here her inspiration specifically with photography from her own country and that history of Qajar photography. And so this is just a wonderful series of juxtapositions where each figure has what the artist calls a modern object. So they have their sometimes forbidden or censored objects. This, for example, is a newspaper that was banned. So these have become incredibly iconic photographs, but I wanted to point them out because the photographer is so aware of the rich, rich photographic history from the Qajar era in Persia, and that's something that we outside of Iran don't necessarily know that much about, but there are incredible amounts of important photography coming out of that era from that time. This is another great one, but the, you know, as she puts it, they're Western or forbidden objects, so we have those again. And so I want to have two more photographers that I want to talk about. And one is Lala Asadi, who is a Moroccan-born photographer who then spent a great deal of time in Saudi Arabia and has actually been in the United States for a few decades now and is an alum of this School of the Museum of Fine Arts. And so this is a piece that we are very happy to have in our collection and that we have had since 2005. It's part of a series called Converging Territories. And Lala Asadi very consciously looks at and reacts to Orientalist painting. So paintings like Anne Frost's Odalisque or the harem, I mean, she even has Her series are frequently named Harem Revisited. This one happens to be Convergent Territories, and she actually stages these photographs in a family home in Morocco where she had been sent to go if she had been disobedient. They were called Houses of Silence. And so today she returns to this place, which is incredibly important for her own memory and personal history, and she stages these photographs where she writes in calligraphy on the drapery, on the figures' bodies, to create these photographs that are very much about process. And I just want to point this out again, is that there's this new tendency ever since Shireen Nishat's Women of Allah for the artists, and particularly for these women artists, to be putting themselves into their work in a different way and something that didn't exist at all previously in photography in the region. So this is a triptych that we are excited to have on view called Bullets Revisited, and I wanted to show this because it's so specifically the Odalis pose, I mean not the exact same pose, but it's the idea of that type of pose. And so to complicate this Orientalist vision, Lala Asadi, if you look carefully at this, it's actually made up of tiny bullets. And so she's woven and sewed the bullets, either sewed them onto the drapery or woven them together to create that divan. And so it's, again, all about this process. And she, Lala, is not necessarily staging herself. This is her niece, but it's all about her personal story and experience. However, this particular series is a really direct response to the Arab Spring and to her personal fears about the growing restrictions on women. So, you know, we see from the early 1800s this new style Orientalist painting, which continued, and, you know, the Orientalist painting did not continue forever, but with the advent of photography, we got away from the specific representations of people starting with landscape, but then we now, today, in the past few decades, are really getting back to some questions that are direct responses to that Orientalism. And the final photographer that I want to talk about is Janan Alami, and I chose her specifically because she is a photographer who has been rigorously studying the history of the photographic medium. She's not only a conceptual artist, but she's also a researcher and has given a great deal of thought to photographic history and specifically to the representation of the Middle East over time since the advent of photography. So she created this work in the mid-90s and at the same time that Shireen Nishat was exploring and doing the Women of Allah series. But Janan Alami was looking back at photographs like this. And so we see, again, this staged portrait with this, you know, this woman reclined, this questions of exoticism and eroticism. And so these are sort of type, you know, maybe we could call them ethnographic types of photographs that were happening in the late 19th century. And they often would end up in the forms of postcards. Here we have one labeled Scenes and Types, a young Moor. And so Janan Alami is really looking directly at these, quote, traditional depictions, particularly of women in photography. And she's actually really drawn to the sort of imagining the relationship between the photographer and the veiled woman. And so she's understanding and looking at these photographs that it seems that there's a frustration on the part of the photographer wanting to unveil these women. And so in order to sort of subvert that relationship and question it, she then decides to parallel the gaze of the photographer with that of the veiled woman, and she created this. So this is one of the photographs of this series, and this is the other one. And they are displayed, and she tells a story as a diptych, and the two photographs are facing each other. And they're meant to be almost mirror images of each other. And the photographer has actually staged herself, her mother, and her sisters, and to different degrees of veiling, and the idea is that the viewer should be literally feel trapped between the gazes of these women. And she wants to sort of bring us back to that moment in the 19th century where European photographers were going in and taking these photographs of veiled women and wanting to unveil them. She's wanting us to think about that specific relationship by staging herself and really creating a new set of parameters in terms of the representation of a veiled woman by staging herself and her family members. So she was looking at that time a lot at the idea of the body as territory. And as I said, that work was done in the mid-90s at a time when discourse surrounding the representation of the headscarf really raged, at some considered to be passé today, others don't, but I should say Janine Alani also curated an exhibition on the veil in 2003 and 2004, which specifically related to the representation of the veil. However, since that exhibition, she has gone on to do a very different, visually different type of work, which again is making a direct reference to the history of the photographic medium and to specific history, photographs of the Middle East. This new work, which is also on view in the exhibition, and it is a video. It's the larger series is called The Aesthetics of Disappearance, and the video is called Shadow Sites 2. As I mentioned, she was looking at the history of photography, particularly of Oriental women, and then with this series, she actually went and did extensive archival research and looked at these archival aerial photographs. These particular ones were taken during World War II, but she also studied Edward Steichen's aerial photographs from World War I, and she did an incredible range of research to then produce her own aerial photographs of the Middle Eastern landscape at a moment during the day when the sun was at its lowest, so either dawn or dusk, and the sun being at its lowest would actually cast shadows of sites that would not otherwise be visible. So here, these W's are actually the shadows of trench walls. So if you were flying over at high noon, you would not see what, you know, it would just look like an empty desert. And that's actually her, one of her arguments is that starting in her lifetime, starting in 1991, the first Gulf War presented the Middle Eastern desert, or the region, as an empty desert. And she was very critical of the fact that it seemed that there were continual neo-Orientalist fantasies projected onto the land. And so she has actually looked into forensic archaeology and sort of what the land can reveal about memory and about history. So we have ancient ruin sites. We have, I'm not sure whether it's abandoned or active military fortresses. And then there's a whole range of aspects of the landscape that we see in this video, and I hope you all get a chance to go look at it, because you actually, in the video, you are sort of burrowed in and out, or telescoped in and out of the images, and her idea is for the viewer to be in the role of the oppressor. And again, she's really looking at these links between power and photography, and the power of a photography, again, to conceal and reveal. So she uses space again, and here's a photograph of the projection room. And I should mention this, the floor is actually sloped and the ceiling is sloped to sort of enhance a disorienting experience. So I wanted to wrap up things with her because she's someone that is really bringing latent myths about the Middle East to the surface through her landscape photographs and then through her video and the way she helps us to see things that we wouldn't otherwise see. And she also, being so conscious of the photographic medium, is sort of a good person to wrap up with, considering that it's very new technology that she's using it, and sort of my initial wanting to draw this parallel between the advent of photography and those initial calotypes and then the albumen prints and moving on through time. Here we have incredible aerial photography taken thanks to the technology of the airplane, and then in video, which of course is a, you know, it's very important for photography today. So I'm happy to take questions. I don't know, I know it's just been welcome.
that those who need to leave can do so quietly. And Kristen, the first question for you.
Thank you. I particularly enjoy hearing you talk about the exhibit. I love that exhibit. And one thing I wondered when you were talking about the obelisks we visited and the triptych of the three, you said that this was showed her concern about the limits on women. And when I look at that and I think about that sort of period in art, is the objectification of women that I see. Is that what you meant by that particular triptych shows her concerns about the limits on women?
That is definitely one of her concerns that she does talk about a fair amount, and particularly when referencing Orientalist painting, because there is that idea of objectifying the woman. In fact, she feels also newer, and this is, you can hear interviews for talking about this as well, so I'm not necessarily putting words in her mouth, but just to quote her, she talks about her fears with, the different revolutions in the Arab Spring, and she talks specifically about Tunisia, but with the rise of Islamist governments, that there are more and more daily restrictions put on the lives of women. And so that's a very real fear for her, which I think adds on to the historical notion of representation of women. So it's sort of a, many fears together. Yeah, I think that she's seeking in using the bullets and having that them be actual bullets that have been used in, the war in Algeria or which was historical, but she went out to, had people go to ancient sites, and so using or even buying contemporary bullets, that was a way to sort of bring these contemporary fears out. So it's a more conceptual reference to those fears today.
The three of us just went to see the fabulous, your fabulous exhibit. And my question is about the women artists and their, if they get any, are they allowed to display this stuff in the Arab countries? And do they have a following in those countries?
Yes, they do. There is a range of photographers in the show, I should say first, that there are a few that don't live in their native countries, but still, other than Shireen Nishat, all travel frequently to their home countries, but for those who are living there today, they all have pretty regular gallery shows. In Tehran, for example, there are 120 private galleries, so every Thursday night there's multiple openings that show many contemporary artists, but including the young Iranian photographers in the show.
Any other questions?
Curious about the borders on these photographs. It almost looks like that technique where you pull out the back of the photograph.
They do sort of look like a Polaroid, right? Yeah. In my mind, her having left these marks from the photographic frame is sort of a reminder of the artifice of photography and this sort of tension between artifice and reality, and the idea of constructive identities. So in, it seems to me a sort of a self-reflexive reference to this idea of artifice through.
Did any of these photographers talk about their own experience of the veil or their mother or grandmother's experience of it?
One interesting anecdote that I could tell you is, I'm sorry to talk about something that we didn't see today, but that's in the exhibition. There's a Yemeni photographer named Bushra Al-Tawako, and she did a series called, it's part of the Veil series, and it's called The Mother-Daughter Doll. It's a highly staged series that is 9 photographs of her, this photographer, Bushra, and her daughter and her doll. And progressively, for those that haven't seen it, they're all dressed very colorfully at the beginning, but wearing a headscarf, and then slowly the color disappears, and the smiles on their faces disappear, and it goes to this drastic end photograph of the series, which is an empty pedestal. So she's looking at the rises of religious extremism and the risks of erasure through individuality. So that said, she is very happy to wear the headscarf in Yemen and feels it's empowering. And actually, there's a great quote on the wall by her, which talks about the complexities of the headscarf. But the anecdote that I wanted to tell you that's directly related to her mother is she has talked about the fact that when her father was assassinated, he worked in the Yemeni government, and her mother then, after that, started to wear the full covering, which she had never done before, so only her eyes are visible. And Bushra said she's had endless arguments with her mother about that, and says, well, why do you do that? And her mother responded, your father was so left-wing and would have never let me do this, but now that he's gone, I'm going to do what I want. So. Yes?
Do you see any instances of self-censorship among younger photographers?
I didn't hear. Do I see any instances of what? Sorry.
Of self-censorship.
Oh, I don't know. I mean, I have to say, for me, all of the work that I was able to meet in terms of the photographers that are in the exhibition, She Who Tells the Story, I have met with all of them and saw all of their work and didn't get the impression that there was a great deal of self-censorship. I can say, though, that a young Iranian photographer named Nusha Tavakolian began as a photojournalist at age 16. And in 2009, had her press card stripped, like all Iranian photojournalists at the time. And so I guess she sort of is operating under somewhat of a, since then, self-censorship, only in that she openly says, well, in photojournalism, I have to be a little bit more careful, but she regularly, still today, is like on occasion on the front of the New York, her work is on the front of the New York Times. But she openly says, in the art world, I can get away with a lot more criticism than I can in photojournalism. So that's sort of I don't know if it's entirely self-censorship, but she's very aware of that.
You've spoken very eloquently about the female photographers. What is the story being told?
And it's a good question, and since one of the reasons why I chose female photographers is that in looking and following contemporary photography in the scene since the 90s, it's felt like the most powerful and provocative work had been done by women. That said, Bahman Javadi, the Iranian photographer who died pretty young a few years ago, I think is also looking in very interesting ways at the history of the medium, and he in fact is one that was an incredible influence on the three younger photographers that I've included in the show. Other photographers like Yousef Nabil, they are also telling interesting stories about different aspects of their identities, and I guess perhaps since Orientalism is such a sort of dominant theme in the visual representation of the Middle East, that it seems particularly compelling to have, that women are actually pursuing the representation of women more than men might be doing. But certainly there's some very powerful work also being produced by men, but it just felt like women's most dominant and the most sort of tangible questions related to identity. So I don't know if that exactly answers it, but and I think also, in general, there are a lot more men doing photo documentary and photojournalism, and that certainly there are men doing creative photography, but it seems like there's perhaps more, or women are exploring more creative photography.
Can
Or that they're, I don't know if it's more licensed, or that they've been, you know, oriented toward that more than they've been oriented to creative photography.
Thank you very much. Okay.